Before we get on to the main part of the agenda, could I ask everybody to stand for a minute silence for the water's point, please? Okay, thank you. Okay, can I remind everybody of members' code of conduct and ask for anybody to declare any interest?
Yes, we have lights to trade in trust here. Lights of number three. So perhaps some lights have been due to the fact that I'm the seconder on the notice of motion. Committee member.
Thank you. Any other declarations of interest? Okay, thank you. Minutes of the last meeting. Does everyone agree on that? Apologies for absence. I've had Tom Shump is in hospital at the moment. Tony Smith has indicated he's going to be late. Louise Weeks Jones has given apologies and Paul Doherty is deputising. So any more apologies? Before we move on to item three, could I just ask the members if they'd be happy to move the financial monitoring report to item four so that we can get the officer in. Yeah. Okay, yeah. Okay, thank you. Okay, so notice of motion. Topic of action applies to them. At the meeting the council held on the 16th of October 2017, the attached notice of the motion for top action on light of it. So can I invite Councillor Burgess Joyce to speak to this, please?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. If you'll allow me to proceed.
You've got 5 minutes.
Thank you very much for allowing me some time this evening to come before this august body. I have not done anything in front of you in the past, so apologies if you don't know who I am. If I could read the actual notice of motion itself, and then obviously follow up with some additional information that I think might be pertinent to the meeting. Council notes that between 2013 and 2016, over 3,600 metric tonnes of fly tip waste was removed, costing the council taxpayers nearly £600,000. Council further notes the damage that fly tipping causes to Woodall's natural environment and wildlife, and the statement from Creek Britain Tidy imploring that it's got to be easy for people to do the right thing, otherwise we will see an increase in fly tipping. Therefore, Council requests that the Cabinet Member for Environment considers 1. Investing in CCTV and automatic number plate recognition technology, or ANPR, to help police fly tipping hotspots. Carr Lane in particular and Lincoln Lane in Morton. Just two such examples that there are now. And that two, instructing officers to ensure that all fly-tipped waste, whether hazardous or non-hazardous, is removed within 3 working days. And clearly the meeting will accept that hazardous waste will be prioritised within that 3-day period. So that's the actual notice of motion. I'm 53 years of age, and it is fair to say that there isn't a day that goes by that I don't wake up and think that I've got the lottery, because I have a Wirral. It is such a beautiful place to live, whether that be the beaches, whether that be some of the beautiful villages that we live in on the Wirral. And I think it's absolutely essential that we remind our people on the Wirral that this is a beautiful place because of the people who live in it, and we need to make it that way. So I think there's some people on the Wirral who, quite frankly, need to be reminded of the fact of how beautiful it is. And we have fly tipping going on in particular parts of the area. Morton seems to be quite prevalent, but we do know other places, and certainly the approaches into Heswell were dealt with, certainly by the chair a few months ago. And I propose, beyond what we've already suggested in the notice of motion, that we as a council look to take a slightly more draconian method with regards to how we deal with offenders. And having done some research into at least 6 councils within England, it is quite common for them to name and shame those who are offenders, and particularly those who are serial offenders. Now there is, I'm sure you're all aware, an opportunity to fine somebody for fly tipping up to £50,000. That is a rarity, and it tends to be for the most heinous of crimes on a regular basis. Councils have the opportunity to fine figures of £150 to £400, which is obviously at the lower end of the scale. This is not going to make any effect for those people who are serial offenders who fly tip. Now, there are certain parts of the community who will offer to clear houses at a very low rate, and the reason why it's at a low rate is because they don't pay any fees to the waste reception depots, because they're dumped on the side of the road. If it continues on the Wirral, it will be blighted beyond belief. We've all been past a part of the Wirral where we've seen some fly tipping take place, and I'm sure all of us have called into the council. This is not a criticism of the council officers in any way, shape or form. I mean, I know work extremely hard to clear up this mess. But I believe it's come to the point now on the Wirral where we need to take slightly heavier measures on those people, particularly those who are repeat offenders in our beautiful peninsula. And I would recommend, beyond what the notion of motion has said, that we actually start to take a slightly heavier hand, particularly with repeat offenders. If this means a naming and shaming policy, then it clearly works in other parts of the United Kingdom. It is, by seen by many, it's probably draconian, but apparently it's had an incredible effect in those areas where it's been trialled. I'm more than happy to provide any information to the meeting of the information due diligence that I've already undertaken before I came here today. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Councillor. I'll open this up to the floor, and then you'll have a vote to reply at the end. Just before I open up to the members, one observation I want to say was when I was pledge champion for the environment, tracking local environment, that was something that I pushed for to name and shame people who were being through the court system. And my logic behind that was if you're before court, it's public order. And I know that officers did take that on board and they did go away. The name and shame has been happening. It's been getting published from the council with press release. Whether the press decide to actually run with those press releases, it's entirely up to them themselves. I do agree that we should be naming and shaming, and I am well aware that that has been happening as well. But I'll open it up to the floor now. Anyone? Ian?
Can I ask a technical question, Chair? I probably should know the answer to this one. In terms of the fines that that are applied to offenders, the fines controlling authority is not the same as, say, speeding fines by the central government. Does the local authority retain the fines that we collect?
going back to the actual wording in the notice of motion, and in the statement it says, statement from Keep Britain Tidy and Boring, that it's got to be easy for people to do the right thing, otherwise we'll see an increase in bicycling. So make it easy is, as far as I'm concerned, is to encourage residents to use the correct process to get rid of their waste. I believe that the system is still in place, Eric, which collects bulky items, single items. What I'd like to see is that the council either offer a service that collects all waste at a reasonable cost that residents can afford, or if that's not possible, to have a register of contractors that will collect this waste, registered by the council. Them names can be given out to residents, and to support them, maybe the council could reduce the cost of the waste period to make them more competitive, to try and give them an edge over people, the cowboy contractors that are taking the money and end up on the other side of the road. So I'd like to see something like that in place, to encourage people to do the right thing. Yeah.
It's very difficult, isn't it, for anybody as a local Lord Councillor to have any great arguments about the wishes behind the notice of motion. I think we'd all like to spend more money on flight tickets, we'd like to spend more money on a whole host of services. But I think the dilemma I would have in fully endorsing this is we haven't got the full facts. We haven't got what we're doing at the moment, what our collection return time is. It's demanding a 3-day working day. If that costs £1 million, I don't know. If that costs a few bob, then we'd have a much more creative argument to put forward to a cabinet member for consideration, and so on and so forth. So, Phil, I think it's Phil Brangwell, the cabinet member, has been very proactive with members. I think he emails on a regular basis. I'm pretty sure he's considering all these options here. But I think this committee is worth more than that. I think we can do more work on our own, of an investigative type. And I am surprised that my opinion about notice of motion. They can be a way of promoting things and getting things done, or there's other systems. And I've noted that no point during this year was flight attendant singled out by any members in the room as part of the WARE programme. That could have been done at the beginning of the year. We could have been in a much better situation had we have given it due consideration. So, you can ask all you like, and the reality is that most of the services that this committee looks after, as I understand, sit in the environment, when we used to get RSG, sat in the environment and leisure package of the RSG, which was also well underfunded from central governments, and most governments, different collections, always underfunded what we actually spent on that basket. But even more so now, most of our attention is being drawn towards those statutory services within adult social care and child care. And that's where the graph of doom takes us. So any request we make from a non-statutory service, which I think some of this is, and how much we spend on it, needs real close consideration. So I would be more, and it's not saying I disagree with it, I'm pretty sure Phil Bradford will have read it and will be considering these issues, but that we actually do some groundwork ourselves. We use this committee and the talents on it for a report to come back to us about where we are, what the situation is, what our response time are now, and then we then put a programme of WARE together, or if that report is thorough enough, we are in a position then to actually, give some one-off demands. And we have to bear in the back of our mind the budgetary situation isn't going to get any easier. Austerity is still around in local government. So I think that argument would be more founded. The other thing that I am finding, and I'll say this quite clearly, it was in the last notice of motion, funny how the random selection of places overseen to be in and around either Walton or the Walton. Now, I don't know whether that is because the co-author is Bruce Berry, or whether they're scared they're going to lose that seat. I just don't think random selections, because we can all put random selections in our policy items. We all have flight in the neighbours around, and you know, we could go on ad nauseum. But my view is that I believe, generally believe, that the sentiments on this committee would be we would want to contribute to a more effective flight in service and flight in prevention service. So my view would be that something along, we notice of motion, and also consider that we also know the public's concern about flight tipping, because it is of great concern, and that somehow this committee take a grip of this situation, and the initial stage would be a report back to a future committee, so we all understand the service fully, and then look at how we demand in cabinet either extra resources or policy changes to make it happen. It's not saying, it's not disagreeing with those motions, it's just using it constructively to do a piece of work. That would be my sentence at the moment.
Okay, thank you, Steve. Adam?
Thanks, Chair. I think I might agree with some of the stuff that Steve said about. I think that there is scope to expand on what's here, because I'd like to see what the effects of removing the brown bin, how the flight tipping, the charge for Eric. And I take Steve's point, you know, we're not swimming in money, but there's a potential to save up to £600,000 here from what it's already costing us if we put some things in place that don't cost us as much of that, and as well as that, improve the area as well. And obviously, that's a good in both ways. So I think, yes, it would be good to say you could remove things within 3 working days, and if that is financially possible, you know, it's a good target to aspire to. But I think I would agree with the things that we need to expand upon here. There's lots more things we need to look at around flight tipping. It is a blight. It's not just one. My ward's particularly affected. It being quite a rural area, we get all sorts. We even get stuff dropped off over the road from the gates of the tip. I mean, on the Ponding Bramble Golf Course, which is just into my residents were complaining about it. So I think it is a particular issue. Yeah, I think expanding the scope would be very much worthwhile.
So, I'm moving next to
Christina. I agree with what Steve said and what Adam said. Where Adam's alluding to is between the two golf courses that we don't want built on the houses. Just a snap line there. Approach to the Clatterbridge roundabout, the rumour went round that there were a lot of cameras there. And all that happened was the flight tipping, instead of being by the two golf courses, was moved to the little lane, Clatterbridge Old Road, which is in Adams Ward. And because everybody said there were no cameras there, and also it was moved underneath the motorway outside Stourton Village. Most of it that we get in the rural areas is commercial waste. We get very little other waste. And I think all of us as councillors are very adept at having a quick look to see if there's any envelopes or anything before we call in. And we do call in. What concerns me is if we put cameras and things up, won't it just move the problem somewhere else? I think that's something we've got to look at. And I think this is such an important area. As you say, there's an awful lot of money here. I would like to see us look at this in a lot more detail and get a lot more information. And I welcome it coming from David and Bruce, but I think it's just a starting point, and I think it's something we really need to look at in more detail.
Interesting. I've got one, and then Chris Cruzy.
Thank you, Chair. I think certainly I agree with tougher action. I think there's always more we can do to try and stop the blight of flight tipping. I'm sure many councillors in the room will agree with me that you find yourselves reporting flight tipping 1 week and then next week there's another couch in the same location. In terms of name and shame, I actually really agree with that. I think it's a great and effective way of doing it. Certainly I utilise my social media as a councillor. If I see flight tipping, I put it up on Facebook, and recently, 12 months ago, I posted a picture of quite a substantial flight tipping in New Ferry. Within 4 hours I had somebody calling me, crying on the phone, saying that they basically paid somebody £15, he turned up in a van and they had all the flights dumped in a van and they left it for him to dump wherever. So I think naming and shaming is effective in some ways. It gets to the root of the problem. I can confirm that person was prosecuted by the council, so it does work. It leads me on to my next issue, is that sometimes fly tipping can actually be a serious organised crime, certainly commercially. You've got big businesses who are, you know, who are making millions and hundreds of thousands of pounds a year. They should be able to go to the local tip that the council run and dump there. They don't, because it's too expensive for them, apparently. And I think that the local authority, and I'd certainly like a response from one of our officers, to try and take tougher action on commercial companies that actually can afford to pay for local authorities. And I also, as Bruce raised, that it should be easier to do the right thing. So I'd like to know what the council's doing to communicate with local businesses who are in the building industry. But I think, you know, we're absolutely right to discuss this at this committee. I would like to see more effective scrutiny, and I welcome it, and I look forward to taking part in it too.
Thank you, Chair. I've got just 2 points really. One, a little bit of answer to Christine's point as well, the cameras. If we put cameras up, will it just move anywhere else? I think yes, it will. But I think the issue with that, though, is we've got, I know, the hotspots where that, in my ward, are totally, you're not going to see it from the street, so they're down there for hours. We put a camera there to stop it from being there. And it's a nice beauty spot as well, because it's based in Country Park. It will move it somewhere else, but it's going to have to move it somewhere where it's going to be seen. And then less likely to do it. The other thing is, we close the tips. The tips aren't run by the council anymore, like the one in Barrington. So they run by another company, they close the flat. Now, building works, so if somebody comes and grips out a kitchen, you shake your head.
In the summer,
in the winter they close the flat, I think. A builder who rips out a kitchen for somebody to put in the kitchen, then goes to the tip, or six, finds it shut, and will notice opposite. Whether you pull the kitchen units and whatever else. So that's an issue for us. But the last point I'd like to make for the top of the chair, just a clarification of what the lady over there said to see about. If it's costing us a lot of money to do this fly tip and clean it up and send it away, and then we take it to court, we get fined in the court, but the fine goes to central government. Why doesn't it come back to the council to replace the cost of us moving the fly tip?
Sympathy with the principle behind the motion, and I agree with practically everything Councillor David Page's judge said about the Whittle being a fantastic place to live, work, visit, etc. I'm sure every councillor in every ward has got a list of examples of what they would regard as hotspots for flight tipping. So when we're talking specifically about putting in CCTV and ANPR, and I think the point's already been made, if we put them in the areas that we all think are hotspots now, apart from the cost, then there is the obvious, you know, question now, well, aren't the people who are guilty of this just going to go somewhere else, just going to go around the corner? So what do we do? We can't just keep moving CCTV and AMPR all around the world. And the other point of the moment, if you look at part two, it's sort of about instructing officers to remove all flight tip waste, within 3 working days. I think, yeah, that sounds great on the face of it, but I think the practicalities are, have we got the resources? Have we got enough officers to ensure that within 3 working days, all flight tip waste is removed? I'm not sure we are. I think Steve mentioned before about austerity. mean, as a council, we're having to make very, very difficult decisions all the time about what to do with the money we've got. So I think it'd be very easy to say, yeah, let's just agree a motion like this and let's do exactly what it asks for. But I think in practical terms, I think it would be very, very difficult. And as far as things like prosecution are concerned, my understanding is that you find, you know, an area of flight tipping, but unless you've got hard evidence, there's no point in taking it to court, because it'll get thrown out. And I think there have been examples in Sue's Norton now. I think there have been examples in the past where we thought we'd identified the guilty people, if you like, gone to court, and we've been told you haven't got the hard evidence, and it gets thrown out, and we waste the time, resources, etc. You know, I'm not sure there is a simple solution. Part of it is education, but we're always banging on to residents and saying, look, you shouldn't light it, you know, you shouldn't act in an antisocial behaviour way, etc. It's partly education, partly enforcement. So what I'm saying here is, I agree totally with the principle behind this motion, but I'm not sure that it's a simple matter. I'm just saying we're going to do what the motion says, and that's going to solve the problem. It's not that simple. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Chair. Just pick up on a point that Councillor Phelps made earlier regarding the wording in the notice of motion. Throughout this year, we have had particularly lots and lots of flights up in a particular area. But due to the fact that it worked well so far, we had a standalone meeting with Councillor Bill Brighton and Mike Colbert to discuss the issues that we had in that area. And I'm not saying it's any worse in that area than anywhere else in the borough. We know that we've all got issues and concerns with the flight tipping. But if you look at the wording actually says to have police flight tipping hotspots such as car lane. It's not specific to car lane, it's just an example. So, you know, it's not that we just want it in that area, we want it for the whole of the world. And just pick up on one point that Councillor Von Moore made about when it happens, you put it on Facebook. We actually did that and said that that we would be looking for evidence, and they came back in the middle of the night and set fire to it, which, you know, caused another problem again. So we decided not to put anything on Facebook.
That happened to me.
Great,
thank you, Bruce. Ian and
Andrew.
I'm interested in the idea of having a list of approved suppliers, if you like, for residents to be able to use to know the confidence that those suppliers that are recommended should be. I think we should have a fair trade scheme in the authority where we would recommend various contractors for various jobs. I think it's quite an interesting idea that Council there is mentioned about having an approved list of companies that we know will not fly to waste, household waste, domestic waste, and whatever. So I think that one needs to be explored, and again, it can't be explored through this motion to a committee. It would be through either a working group or office or whatever. But I think that is worth exploring if it helps to reduce the £600,000 cost to the local authority. In terms of CCTV, I think we're kind of assuming that there isn't any CCTV. In the good old days when I was a councillor for Leeson, we had, and it was good old days too, when we had a particular problem on Ditton Lane, which was an undoctored road, residents nearby were fed up with it, and I remember working with officers to try and persuade some of the residents' offices who would accept CCTV being installed in their properties to film this, and because of the problems there, no resident would accept having cameras in their home, even if we recognise it's a problem. So we are willing, as I think, as an authority, to take on CCTV, but how widespread that is, I don't know. Perhaps the officers can advise on that. I agree with Sue's point. I think we do need to look at this in more detail. For no other reason than we don't want to drive past it, the tip of a ship tire, a man road, or, you know, whichever board it's in, or Ditton Lane or wherever. But I'm also interested to know, as a committee, as a council, whether we can push for this as an issue through whatever canals as possible devolution agenda, because if we're devolving powers from government to wherever, it would make sense to devolve the revenue from the income from this, from fines, to local authorities, because then we would have a clear incentive as an authority to pursue more cases through court to obtain fines that they're back into the pot for whatever they're not using for. So I think, again, that's a piece of work that we will go through as a council to say why can't those fines be devolved to local authorities, either city regions or local councils, because otherwise, at the moment, there's no incentive apart from the penalty notice reason. I think as Sue has explained, doesn't really cover the cost of the whole I think the merits in a lot of what people said there just need further work. But I'm quite happy to mention the board, I don't mind at all.
Okay, thank you. Andrew, and I'll come on to Chris.
Right, well, I don't want to labour all the points because I think everyone's put there, we can get on this. Just to condense what Steve Fowles was saying, I agree with you, Steve, that we do have to look at this in more detail. We as councillors had to work with the officers to highlight all the hot spots around the world, give as much information through as we can, because I believe that we can bring down 600,000, as Ian said, and if we can sort of get the money to come back to us, it will help create a force of people who could pick all the stuff up. There's just one thing I wanted to know about, was, we talked about highlighting people in the press. Do we leave it to the press to pick up from courts who've been through, or does our press department work with yourselves to say, do you know, we've done all these people this week, you can put it in the press course?
I can answer that, Councillor. Yesterday we did have a successful fly tip prosecution in court. The perpetrator was fined, we put in for compensation, we were looking, we got compensation costs for clear up, they were ordered to pay our costs, etc. We have contacted the press office today to say that can we have a press release on this, but as Councillor Paul Stewart said, we do report these matters to press, but then it's up to them whether they actually...
Well, there's nothing starting to put in the middle of it.
Yeah, just one quick point actually, if I may, Chair. Just looking at point number two, about the 3 working days. The last time I was involved with fly tipping, a guy put in some new fencing on a big row of fencing, so you can see there was 3 pieces brand spanking new, and the rest of it he tipped right next to the library in Eastern Village. So when I asked him to move it, he said, well, it's not council land, council move it. So my point is, the better we get at removing fly tipping really quick, more people might be tempted to think, oh, I'll just dump it because it'll be gone in a couple of days. The council will move it really fast. So there's got to be a correlation between how well we do that, how well we can catch people fly to it. It's not an either or, is it? It's got to be both. There's got to be a team close to that.
Okay, thank you.
Chair, I think we just keep it very brief. I think the one point we make in terms of the 2 specific actions in the motion, I think we just highlighted talking to Sue earlier that things like CCTV, putting the equipment in and installing it on the ground is one thing, but some of these things can actually have fairly significant resource and officer time implications to do them. So that's a consideration. And certainly we have that contract with BIFA, with that working with that standard, which I think is 5 days at the moment. So obviously if we're looking to change that standard with BIFA, we have to do that via contract. So again, there can be resource implications with that. Overall. So there's the enforcement aspect. I think we come back to the fact that the emphasis here is around it's got to be easy for people to do the right thing. And just make the point, of course, as a number of members have highlighted,
this isn't just about the enforcement side. We're working really hard on the educational side through the local programme, through the ERIC service, through the household waste reception centres run by the MRWA that are dotted around the world. So we're working really, really hard to have a complementary approach where it's about enforcement, but we are trying to make it as keep the entirely closed as, you know, it's got to be easy for people to do the right thing. But as officers, you know, we'd be very, very happy and welcome the opportunity to come back with a more detailed report as a starting point. And I think a good starting point would be, we've had a whole series of questions and points of detail today that would form the basis of a first note back, I think, as Councillor Fowkes says, to move the discussion along.
Okay, so.
Thank you, Chair. Just for clarity, the legislation to install covert CCTV cameras in any particular hotspot location requires us to jump through hoops, really, and at the end of it is to obtain a magistrate's authority for us to install those CCTV cameras, those covert CCTV cameras. It is a lengthy process. We have to prove that that particular location has been heavily fly-tipped before we even prepare the notice to go to court to get that authority. So that's a lengthy process as well, to prove that and to make sure that there's no collateral intrusion. Some of the locations that we go into, there's a lot of visitors to that location, so they could be captured on that CCTV. And that's everything that we have to consider before we even install the cameras.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm going to wait for Councillor Burgess to close.
Thank you, Chair. Thank you, Chair. I've listened to all that's been said, and in fairness, I didn't come to this with a political agenda. There's not a person in this room, whether they are left, right, centre, who would disagree with the sentiments, I think, of what we're trying to do. It's possibly how we intend to do it that we're having a little bit of a pinch point. What I think is slightly the problem, and I think you may have alluded to it, Sue, is that I want you to go through hoops. Having worked for the Serious Organised Crime Agency, I'm well aware of the difficulties of putting in covert cameras and covert surveillance. So I do understand how difficult it can be. I fully understand that. But if you look at those councils around the country that have actually made an example, and I mean a real example, and I do take Councillor Lord's very valid point actually about it's not just individuals, it's not residential necessarily, it's also business as well. Some of these businesses are run by people who don't live on the road, so aren't really perhaps as caring of our environment as we are. But I want those people to be on the front of the Echo. Now, I'm Dave Melreader, I don't like the Liverpool Echo, but there's one thing about the Liverpool Echo I do.
Yes! You do all
that, sir. One thing I do like about the Liverpool Echo is that last year they made a very good support of Borough Council around litter, and we were asked for our comments. And I have to say, they were very good in what they wrote. I think we need to work closely with those people, because those councils that have actually done this have reduced their costs by 60%, because people genuinely do not wish to show their children and their grandchildren that when they're Googled, their name comes up as having been a fly tipper. And we've got examples around the country where people have dropped cigarette butts and have been prosecuted and then shamed. That's not something people want to have. And if we're not doing that, then all we're doing is reacting. And I know CCTV and I know AMPR are difficult issues to investigate. I have to say, I didn't support this purely because of those two areas that were mentioned. It could be anywhere, it could be in yours, Councillor Kelly. I genuinely don't care. As long as we get one or two people who the public of the will can see have been named and shamed. Because I guarantee you that will reduce a lot of that enormous £600,000 burden. I'm not asking you to spend more money. I'm actually asking you to save money. And we need to think of a different way rather than just being reactive. We need to be proactive. And I genuinely think that part of that is the naming and shaming process. Whether that be an employer, whether that be a resident, it doesn't matter. It sounds draconian, I accept, but it has to be done, and it will save us money because it's been approved in other councils to do so. So thank you very much for your time. I appreciate you listening to your rabbit hole, but I make no apologies for you for the Daily Mail. And I hope I've made my point. Thank you very much.
Has anybody got any proposals?
I'll prepare something if this plans. Committee, note the report, note the notice motion, and the public's concern around the area of the issue of flight tipping. Committee calls for a full report at a future meeting with this committee so members can review this area service more fully than make appropriate recommendations.
Okay, does anyone want to like anything?
That's it.
Second. Are we all agreed on that?
Yep, agreed.
Agreed. Okay. Thanks very much. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Okay, as agreed, guys, and we have moved to financial monitoring report now. Financial reports on pages
32. Thank you, Chair. As you mentioned, I think this might be a fan, whatever, in the name of the system, get the fans. That's a better fan, which is some sort of retires from after 44 years. Firstly, an apology, I won't really go to a presentation on finance. Perhaps quite something to pick up as we go through. We're looking at the budget here. There's a lot of disparity areas. I think we've got 30 budget heads to pick up the area, but we'd rather be looking at taking it for 30. Is there any particular one to go on, go through? Perhaps a future meeting I can do that. Okay, very good for the balance fees, £1.69 million. Table 2 on page 36 shows that the current forecast, new forecast, is an early spend of £895,000 per year. Okay. That's at 1.5% of budget in terms of figure. It's improved by about 24,000 since quarter one, so it's sort of moved that way, but there's still a number of issues in terms of revenue. Okay. Section 3.33, so that will align similar to the areas as opposed to the problem. I think there's an assumption that there would be a sale on the waste and environment contract about £500 a year. We're running up about 1,000 so far. That's £1.4 million down. There's some work we've been taking to try and make that better to improve that situation. There's a few pressures in terms of leisure areas as well, and some savings predicated on some capital scheme taking place. Some of those things are still being delayed. Nothing that have impact on revenue. There's a bit of loss of income on golf, £40,000.